Dr. Marina Guirguis Hanna is a urogynecologist board certified in obstetrics and gynecology at Inova Health Systems. She joined Inova in 2023 and has been practicing since 2016. Prior to joining Inova, Dr. Guirguis Hanna was a urogynecology and pelvic reconstructive surgery fellow at McGee Women's Hospital at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center. She has experience in minimally invasive surgery and treats pelvic organ prolapse, urinary and fecal incontinence, obstetric trauma, and abnormalities of the urogenital tract. Dr. Guirguis Hanna's clinical areas of interest include overactive bladder, urinary incontinence, and quality improvement outcomes. Our second speaker is pelvic health therapist Stephanie McKenna. Stephanie received her bachelor's degree with top honors in exercise science from Florida State University in 2012, where she competed as a collegiate swimmer. She then received her Doctor of Physical Therapy from Mercer University in 2018 and has worked for Inova since 2019. Stephanie has a passion for treating and helping all individuals with pelvic floor and orthopedic dysfunction, with a special interest in pre-postpartum and pelvic pain conditions. Now I'm going to turn the program over to our speakers.
All right, so we'll get started. So my part of the conversation is going to just discuss really the basics of, you know, urinary incontinence and how, you know, our bladders work and, you know, the different types of issues that can come up. So just as an overview, we'll go over some basic anatomy and physiology. We'll have a general overview of urinary incontinence, specifically especially stress urinary incontinence and urgency urinary incontinence. So starting with anatomy and physiology, this is meant to be a representation of your pelvic floor. This is, you know, if you were sitting on an exam table and you had your legs in the stirrups, you would see that you have three holes. The first is your urethra, where you pee from, you have the vagina, and then you have your rectum. And so if we were to slice this photo in half and look from the side, we would see that the urethra is connected to your bladder. We would see that the vagina has your uterus and your cervix at the top of it. And then we have your rectum underneath. And surrounding these three very important organs is a bowl of pelvic floor support. And so that's made up of muscles, ligaments, all sorts of things that are attached to your bony pelvis, as you can see in the corner. And so when we're talking about the way that a bladder's, you know, cycle normally works, we get signals sent from our brain to the bladder. And as the bladder is filling, the brain is telling the bladder that it needs to relax. It has to relax so that it can stretch and fill and, you know, completely fill with urine until you're ready to actually empty. And when you finally feel ready to empty, then your brain sends signals to your bladder telling it that it's time now to contract. And so when that signal is sent, the bladder then contracts, it squeezes, and then you're able to void. And so urinary incontinence is when you have involuntary loss of urine. And so what happens in situations of urinary incontinence is you leak urine. This is something that happens in up to about 50% of women across all ages. You know, this is based on self-report. And so there is the possibility of actually it being more common. And I think that's really what we see, you know, in our practice. And why is it important to even bother with this, to treat this? You know, it's meant to improve your quality of life. It's meant to improve sexual satisfaction. It's meant to decrease skin irritation and infection. And we know that urinary incontinence is very costly. You know, some research has shown us that the average woman with severe urinary incontinence will actually pay about $900 a year for routine care. And that's, you know, things like pads and Depends and, you know, all kinds of things that come as a result of urinary leakage. So what are the types of urinary leakage? The first is what we call stress urinary incontinence. And this is when you have urine leakage with coughing, laughing, sneezing, jumping, running, any sort of activity. You have urgency urinary incontinence, and that's that leakage when you're on the way to the bathroom, maybe as you're pulling down your pants, you can't quite get it in time. Or that lock and key syndrome, you know, you're fine as you're driving home, and then the minute that you see the door and the key is in the lock, you know, you have that leakage because your bladder is like, nope, I'm going now. And then we have something called a mixed urinary incontinence. And just like it sounds, it's a combination of the stress type of leakage and the urgency type of leakage. There's urinary incontinence during intercourse, and that could either be stress-related or urge-related, and we'll go into a little more detail a little bit later. So with stress urinary incontinence, again, this is the leaking with coughing, laughing, sneezing, maybe jumping on the trampoline, going for a run, if you're squatting to, you know, grab something. This is what we call stress urinary incontinence. This is typically a mechanical problem. So as you can see here, this is, you know, my diagram again. We have, again, our urethra, where you're peeing from with your bladder. And this gray area here represents some of the support structure that really acts to prevent you from leaking. So what happens here is you get pressure from above, whether it's a big cough or you jumped or, you know, had a big run. And what happens is this ligament or this support area is supposed to prevent your urethra from just moving and causing you to leak. And so what happens often with childbirth, you know, or other kind of traumas is you get a break in the support structure. And when you have that, you know, that injury to the ligament, you end up leaking when you have pressure from above. And so the important thing is, right, what are our treatment options? The number one thing that I tell patients who come to my office is, you know, if you didn't want to do anything about it, you don't have to do anything about it. You know, urinary leakage is not something that, you know, is going to harm your health or not something that's going to, you know, kill you. But, you know, it can be very bothersome. But if you're one of those people where you're like, it happens from time to time, it's not that, you know, frequent, it's not super bothersome, you don't have to do anything. Most of the time, by the time you've made it into my office, you're like, I've done nothing. It's done nothing. What's number two? Option number two is doing behavioral modifications. So things like limiting fluid intake, you know, not really drinking excessive amounts of fluid. And, you know, we know that you really only need about 50 to 60 ounces of total fluid per day. You really don't need, you know, these 8 glasses of water plus the coffee and the tea and, you know, all the other things that you're drinking. Timing your voids. So if you're somebody who's leaking when you're coughing, laughing, and sneezing, but you're only going to the bathroom once or twice a day, you're probably allowing your bladder to fill up just too much that you are leaking. And so timing your voids where you're going every 3 hours or every 4 hours is a good way to help decrease that. And then weight loss. You know, there's definitely data that has shown us that having obesity, being overweight, can actually significantly make leaking worse. And even dropping as little as 5% of your body weight can improve your urinary symptoms. Now, let's say you've done the behavioral modifications and you're like, okay, I'm still having leakage. Another thing that you can do is pelvic floor physical therapy. I won't go into too much detail because Steph is going to go through a lot of this with you. But something, you know, that you hear all the time is Kegels. Do your Kegels. You know, when you're sitting at a stoplight, you're doing whatever, do your Kegels. You know, and we found that about 70% of women aren't really doing Kegels when they think they're doing Kegels. Usually, instead of squeezing those pelvic floor muscles that we see here on the right, they're squeezing their glutes or, you know, their thigh muscles or things like that. And physical therapy is a really great way to understand what muscles you're activating and which ones are the right muscles to use to help prevent that leakage with the cough and the sneeze and the jump. And the nice thing with pelvic floor physical therapy is there's no risk with it. It can only help. And really anybody can prescribe it. So even if you're not seeing a urogynecologist such as myself, your primary care can refer you to physical therapy. Your OBGYN can refer you to physical therapy for urinary incontinence. And another option on the more conservative side of the spectrum is to use something called a pessary. A pessary is a silicone device that sits inside the vagina. It sits in a way, as you can see here in this picture, that it really helps to support the urethra. So again, that ligament that used to be around the urethra has been injured in some way, shape, or form. And so since you don't have that support anymore, the pessary can provide that support. There are a few different kinds. You know, some of them include a platform, some of them don't have a platform, but all of them have this extra little notch that basically sits under that urethra to support it. The, you know, beauty of this is it's not surgery. It doesn't require any sort of anesthesia. We fit you for it in the office and you're usually going home with it the same day. It can be something that you take out and put in yourself. Or if you don't want to, you know, manage it, then you do that through the office and you can use it as much or as little as you want. So if there are, you know, there are people who, oh, I only leak if I go on a run or I only leak if I'm jumping on a trampoline, maybe just put it in for those activities. Whereas if you're somebody who's leaking with every position change or every time you have a sneeze or a cough, you might wear it more consistently. Again, the nice thing with this too is, you know, these that have the diaphragm can also help with prolapse. So if you have leaking and also prolapse, the pessary helps both. And then, you know, we know that about 75% of women see improvement of their symptoms having the pessary in place. And again, this is something that can be temporary while you're, you know, getting ready to have surgery. Or if this is, you know, your option that you're happy with, or maybe you're, you know, worried about surgery, whatever the situation is, you can do pessary for life. Now, we've exhausted our conservative management, and now our options are surgery. There are a few different surgical procedures that we can do to help with leaking, with the coughing, laughing, and sneezing. The first one is something called a midurethral sling. This is a mesh, different from the mesh that you typically hear about when, you know, people talk about the lawsuit mesh and all of that. We'll get into that in just a second. But the way that this works is this mesh is placed underneath the urethra through the vagina, and it's basically acting to recreate that ligament that was once working really well and has since gone injured. And it basically creates this, you know, new ligament by your body kind of scarring it into the right place. It acts like a hammock so that when you do have the pressure coming from above, your urethra is not just flailing around and then you leak. It really helps to keep it in place. This procedure gives you about an 80 to 85% chance of being completely dry, meaning you don't leak at all with coughing, sneezing, moving. And then again, you know, anytime you have a foreign body, there's always a risk of complications, similar to having like a knee replacement, hip replacement, anything that's foreign, there's always a tiny chance of a risk of having a complication. It's about 1 to 3% chance. And the most common risk is that the mesh starts to peek out through the skin of the vagina. And if that happens, we usually can treat it, you know, in the office and, you know, not have to go back for surgery. Rarely, you may have to have the mesh taken out later on. But this is, again, like a pretty rare occurrence. So, you know, we mentioned the mesh that created a lot of problems for women that resulted in, you know, some lawsuits and things being taken off the market. So again, this is different from that mesh. And just a tiny history lesson, we, you know, the mesh that had caused a lot of problems back in 2008, the FDA issued a public health notification because, you know, we had realized that there were a lot of issues coming with vaginally placed mesh for prolapse. And then a few years later, they reclassified this vaginal mesh again for prolapse as being now a high risk type of mesh. And then in 2016, they classified it as a high risk. And then in 2019, the FDA ended up taking it off the market. So, you know, again, this whole, you know, class of mesh that was placed for something completely different has been off the market since 2019. And so if, you know, we're talking about mesh in a urogynecologist's office, this is a different mesh than what you're, you know, what you hear all those commercials and things like that about. Now, let's say you're not interested in mesh, you're still a little bit hesitant about that idea, or maybe you're wanting to do something that's, you know, like one of the least invasive, you know, procedures you could do. You have an option of something called urethral bulking. Again, this is still a permanent material, and there are a few different kinds that exist out there. But essentially what this does is it helps to really bulk up the urethra. So I kind of liken it to if you get fillers in your lips to bulk the lips up. It's kind of the same thing, but in the bladder, neck, or in the urethra. And so what happens, as you can see on the right here, is a little camera goes into the urethra, and then you have a few injections where now there's some bulking material, where if you're looking at the urethra, it starts out open, and then by the time that we inject this material, now it's closed. And so this is basically a way where when that pressure comes from above with a cough or a sneeze, you have pressure from below helping to, you know, resist it from opening the urethra and causing you to leak. This is a great option for, you know, women who maybe are really bothered by their urinary leakage, but are still wanting to have, you know, future children and deliveries and things like that, you know, because it does work for, you know, about 7 years, give or take, and it can be touched up. And, you know, it likely does require having touch-ups in the future. So it's maybe not quite as durable as something as this sling, but it is a good option for, you know, people who are still trying to conceive, maybe people who are looking for the quickest or least invasive thing. This is a good option. Another sling that we have is, again, a non-mesh sling. So if you're still, you're like, okay, I want something a little more durable maybe than the bulking, but I don't want the mesh, you can do something called a pubovaginal sling. This is a sling, again, that goes underneath the urethra, but it's using your own tissue. So it requires either an incision in your lower abdomen or an incision in your leg, where we harvest that fascia, which is that stronger tissue, and we place it at the bladder neck. This is something that is a little more involved. Recovery is a little more involved because you have more incisions, you know, and there are some, you know, higher rates of not being able to empty your bladder after this procedure, requiring you to, you know, have a catheter a little bit longer term or to catheterize yourself. And it, you know, does have some higher rates of new urinary urgency and frequency after it's placed. But it is an option for people who, you know, again, are mesh averse or have a reason that they can't use mesh. Another non-mesh option is something called a birch urethropexy. This is where we basically put sutures on either side of the urethra to help kind of, again, lift things up and create support around the urethra where you pee from. And this basically attaches it to the ligament behind your pubic bone. This one, again, is a procedure that is, you know, an option for people who maybe don't want mesh or aren't candidates. It does require entry into the abdominal cavity. So it's usually done laparoscopic or robotic, where you have four or five incisions on your abdomen. And, you know, you do go through the abdomen to get there. And so that's kind of the general overview for that stress urinary incontinence, which is the leaking with coughing, laughing, sneezing. Moving on to the urgency urinary incontinence, that's the leaking with the urge to go to the bathroom. Again, running to the bathroom, pulling down your pants, any sense of urinary urgency and then leaking. Or maybe you don't necessarily leak urine, but you have overactive bladder. So you're having urinary urgency, you're having frequency where you're going every 30 minutes or every hour. Or maybe you're waking up 3, 4, 5 times a night. It's the same mechanism, whether you're leaking or not leaking, that urinary urgency and frequency. This is more of what we call a physiologic problem. So it's not so much a mechanical problem like, oh, I had a child and, you know, having that vaginal delivery, you know, injured support structure, so much as you're getting a lot of this signal from your brain to your bladder saying, hey, it's time to contract, you need to empty, and then you're leaking appropriately or leaking too early. And so that's where our focus is on. Again, our treatment options for this is we could do nothing. Second option, again, behavioral modification. So again, you know, making sure you're not drinking too much. This one, maybe instead of timing your voids more frequently, you're trying to kind of space out your voids. So if you're like, okay, I'm going to the bathroom every 30 minutes, starting to say, okay, you know what, the next time I need to go to the bathroom, I'm going to delay it by 15 minutes. And you do that for a week. And then you go from 45 minutes to every hour. And you go on until you get to that 3 hour mark. Other things that you can do are avoiding or reducing bladder irritants. And so those are things like alcohol, spicy foods, coffee, you know, citrus type of foods and drinks as well, chocolate, sweeteners, and so on. So these are all things that could potentially irritate your bladder. And so kind of trying to stay away from some of those things and seeing if it makes a difference. And then again, weight loss. That 5% applies really for both types of leakage. Physical therapy, again, is a very, very good option for this type of urinary leakage. You know, in addition to the things, you know, like Kegels and so on, they also work with you on urge suppression techniques, ways to get you to the bathroom in time or to help you delay needing to go to the bathroom and so on. And then sometimes, again, your pelvic floor muscles are all kind of surrounding your entire pelvis, your vagina. And if those muscles are tight, then it can cause increase in your urinary leakage. And working with the physical therapist can help to basically relax those tight muscles so you can actually use them properly. And, you know, there are various reasons why your muscles might be tight in the vagina. You know, it could be because of any sort of pelvic trauma. So it could be pelvic surgery. It could be sexual trauma. It could be a vaginal delivery. Any of those things can make those muscles reflexively tighten. And then when those muscles are constantly activated, you can't really use them to stop the flow of urine. And so the physical therapist will work with you on relaxing those muscles out so you can more appropriately use them. You know, so again, a really good option for either kind of incontinence. And then our next option for this type of leakage is medications. So again, right, we have two signals from your brain to your bladder. One is telling it to relax, one is telling it to contract. One class of the medication stops this contract mechanism, and one class of medication promotes the relaxation. So they both have kind of the same end goal in mind, but each one works on a slightly different receptor in the bladder. So the anticholinergic medications, these are things you may have heard like ditropan, Besicare, you know, Fenacin, like all these different medications that, you know, are very common. They're typically cheaper. There are a ton of options, but they do have side effects. You could have side effects of dry eyes, dry mouth, constipation. You know, we have some data now telling us that there's an association with dementia the longer that you use these types of medications. And if you have certain types of glaucoma, you can't use those medications. You know, so as you're going to call, typically our preferred type of medication is what we call these beta 3 agonists. And that's where we're promoting relaxation of the bladder so it can stretch and fill. These have fewer side effects. One of the types of medications has no side effects, and the other one might elevate the blood pressure just a little bit. But these are not always covered by insurance, so sometimes they can be costly. And there are only two options as it stands currently. Now, let's say you've tried all of these things and you're still having leakage, you know, and you have what we call third tier therapy. So this is now the next step. We're talking about doing something, you know, more on the procedural side. Our first option is something called PTNS. This is the posterior tibial nerve stimulator. And this is where basically we put an acupuncture type needle right near your ankle. It stimulates this nerve that goes all the way up from your ankle up to your bladder. And you do this every week for about 12 weeks, and then typically end up needing to do maintenance about once a month. Minimal risks, minimal side effects. It works for about 50% of people. So this is definitely an option for people who are, you know, past medications, but looking for the least kind of invasive thing, but it is a big time commitment. The second option is to do Botox in your bladder. You know, we hear about Botox for the face, we hear about it for all these other things, but you can also use Botox for your bladder. It is approved by the FDA for overactive bladder and urge-related leakage. Of all the options we have, it gives you the highest chance of being dry, meaning having no leaking. You do have about a third of people end up having a urinary tract infection after. And it can be done office, which is nice. It does require a repeat injection. So this is done every 6 to 12 months, depending on how long it lasts for you. And again, I mean, you can see here, you have a little camera, it goes through the urethra, and then you have, you know, a handful of basically little injections where we inject the Botox. And, you know, you're usually numbed up inside the bladder, inside the urethra for this. But it's a good option for people who, you know, are past kind of medications and are interested in something longer acting. And then in terms of last kind of options, we have something called sacral neuromodulation. This is basically where we're stimulating the nerves that go to the bladder. And this, you can do a test phase in the office, which is a really cool thing where you don't have, it doesn't commit you to doing any sort of implant. It's just a good way to see if you would even be a responder. So you would come to the office, we would stimulate the nerves for anywhere from 5 to 7 days. And then we basically would see if there's an improvement or not. And then if there's an improvement, then you get to the full implant where we're putting a teeny tiny battery kind of in the fat of your bottom, and then a wire goes to the nerve that goes to the bladder and the bowels. So the nice thing about that is it not only treats urgency related leakage of urine, it also treats urgency and leakage of like fecal matter, so accidental bowel leakage. So if you're having, you know, both types of issues with control, this is a really good option for you. We have some that are rechargeable, some that are non-rechargeable. It can last anywhere from 15 to 20 years and basically can just replace the battery at that point for another 15 to 20 years. So this is another good option. Has no risk of, you know, getting an infection in your bladder the way that the Botox does. Now, mixed urinary incontinence, again, this is the urine leakage where you have both the leaking with coughing, laughing, and sneezing, as well as the leakage with the urge. You know, with this type of leaking, sometimes treating one helps the other, but there's not really good data to say if, okay, if I treat the stress kind, it'll definitely get rid of the urgency kind, or if I get rid of the urgency kind, it'll definitely get rid of the stress kind. You know, a lot of people have tried to look at this, and it's pretty much you can start down one pathway or the other. And sometimes it takes care of the other one, but not always. Now, excuse me, what if you're having leakage during sex? This is something that can be really distressing for women. This can be either stress incontinence related, so it's similar to the coughing, laughing, sneezing, or the urge related incontinence, which is again with the urge. Typically, if your leaking is more associated with actual penetration of the vagina, that's usually the same mechanism as that mechanical stress incontinence. If, let's say, it's typically associated with orgasm, so that could be during sex, it could be during masturbation. If you're noticing leakage during that time, it's typically what we call urgency urinary incontinence. And again, you could have the combination of the two. So in summary, urinary incontinence is very, very common among women. There are multiple types of urinary incontinence. One size definitely doesn't fit all. What works for one person may not work well for another person, whether it's in terms of treatment response or what makes sense for your life. If urinary incontinence bothers you, there are multiple treatment options and multiple urogynecologists here in this area who would love to help. And again, this is an overview. So each person's health and status is unique. It may affect which options are reasonable for you specifically. So make sure to discuss it with your doctor. You know, again, like one thing may work great for somebody and may not be an option for somebody else, but talking with your physician or your provider can really make a difference in, you know, finding the right option for you. So, you know, don't be afraid to ask your doctor about it. Don't be afraid to advocate for yourself. If you're having these problems and it's bothersome to you, definitely, you know, let your doctor know, reach out to one of us and we're happy to help. And I'm going to pass it along to Steph.
Now you can probably hear me. Dr. Guirguis, can you see the screen okay?
It's doing the thing from before.
Okay, we'll try again. Better? Fantastic. Thank you all for having us. And thank you, Sue and Kim, for putting this on, and Dr. Guirguis for joining us. I'm going to cover the pelvic floor component of some of the concepts that Dr. Guirguis has already touched on regarding urinary incontinence and overactive bladder. So just a quick review of some of the things that Dr. Guirguis already mentioned. There are several different types of incontinence, and we can kind of tailor our treatments based on what we're seeing symptomatically, as well as what we're seeing in tests and different diagnostic that urogyns and or PCPs or medical providers can provide to us. But again, that review is stress, urge, mixed, functional, and overflow. And your doctor and or physical therapist can help guide you to determine which incontinence you're experiencing. The biggest thing that I want everyone to remember is that you're not alone. There are millions of people in the world that experience urinary incontinence, fecal incontinence, bowel and bladder dysfunction. And that's irregardless of age or gender. It's not just an older age type of problem. It's not only a postpartum problem. It can be across the lifespan. So personally speaking for myself, I've seen someone at the as young as the age of 15, and then I've seen someone as old as the age of 101. So just because age is, you know, maybe not as moving as well, we can still do things and we can still try to make you as functional as possible while trying to help your symptoms. So defining pelvic floor and what that means in this setting. So pelvic floor physical therapy looks at the muscles of the pelvis themselves, and that can include an internal and external evaluation, which we'll get into in a little bit. But like Dr. Guirguis says, the pelvic muscles are a set of muscles that lie at the base of the pelvis. So right now you're sitting on top of your pelvic floor, supported by the pelvic bones and the muscles that lie in between. So they connect directly to the pelvic, abdominal wall, sacrum, and tailbone. So you can imagine dysfunction in any of those regions along with the hip or leg can create pelvic floor issues and can coincide with different dysfunctions that we see. The functions of the pelvic muscles themselves are to contract, which is to assist incontinence. They're to relax in the setting of letting urine pass or flow. And they're also to lengthen, which is what we need to do to be able to allow stool to pass through. Like I said, the three main functions, including the muscle function in themselves, is a supportive system. So it helps to support the organs that lie in the pelvic girdle, which are your bladder, your uterus, your bowels, and then the intestinal components. And then continence as far as toileting, and then they aid in sexual function. We'll get to that video in a second here on the next slide. So a lot of the questions that we get is, what is a Kegel and how do I do it? So before I even show the video, what I want you all to do is just think about and maybe even close your eyes and take a good deep breath in. And I want you to exhale and try to lift your perineum off of the seat that you're sitting on. Those muscles, when they contract, they squeeze and they lift to close the openings or the holes that lie in the pelvic girdle. So if we look at this video, what they're going to show you is a woman coughing, and you can see the response that the muscles have inside the pelvis. So you can see as she coughs, those muscles squeeze and they force close the three openings of the rectum, the vagina, and the urethra to keep you continent. So where things can go wrong and where we can help with. A lot of times people think, oh, I've tried my Kegels, I've done all of these different movements, but my symptoms are not getting better. That doesn't necessarily mean that Kegels aren't correct for you. Maybe you're doing them incorrectly, or we just don't have the range of motion in the muscles to be able to create that force that we need to be able to actually sustain and close those holes I was talking about. So what we look at as pelvic floor physical therapists is what's actually happening in the muscles and where can we intervene. So when it comes to just muscle weakness, it can be something that's happened over time with the aging process or atrophy, maybe decreased mobility from a surgery or a different event in your life, or it can be traumatic, such as with childbirth or with a delivery that was a little bit more aggressive towards the pelvic muscles. And what this is typically correlated with is functional incontinence, some types of stress incontinence where those muscles just aren't strong enough to withstand that force. It can be associated with pelvic organ prolapse or the descent of the organs, and it can also be correlated with recurrent hip or low back pain. The muscle tension or imbalance component of it is usually the muscles, like Dr. Guirguis says, they just can't relax. And so those muscles just need a little bit more range of motion to be able to kind of move and get stronger to support you in that function. So what we look at is kind of how are these muscles imbalanced and where can we get more length to be able to create more strength. And this is usually correlated with frequency or urgency, whether it's during the day or night. Urged or mixed incontinence, pelvic, abdominal, back, or hip pain, constipation, or overflow incontinence, which is where your bladder is actually overstretched, and therefore we're not able to fully empty each time when we try to urinate. The last group is poor coordination. A lot of times we see this with stress incontinence, where the muscles just aren't contracting at the right time. And so what we focus on is getting the muscles to work with our bodies at the right time in the right place. A lot of times we see this also with pelvic prolapse, recurrent low back pain, and again, a lot with constipation. Defining what we do within the sessions that you go through with our pelvic floor physical therapy. So it's a conservative treatment option, so there's little to no risk, just like Dr. Guirguis says, and I'm not going to go through all of these diagnoses, but these are just a handful of diagnoses that we treat within the pelvic floor physical therapy realm, and that, again, can be men and women, can be irregardless of age, pain, leakage, incontinence, constipation, bowel dysfunction. We treat it all, and we can kind of help with a lot of these symptoms. So what can we do, and kind of what is the research saying? It's basically saying that, hey, it's better than not doing anything at all. So regardless of whether or not you find 100% resolution of your symptoms, that's kind of up to you and the commitment and kind of what's going on with the actual muscles and the function. But it's better than not doing anything at all or doing anything by yourself. Having that good evaluation and really understanding the body really does help to support and reduce the amount of symptoms with urinary leakage. So what to expect on the day of your evaluation. So after obtaining your referral for physical therapy from any kind of medical provider, a doctor of physical therapy will evaluate what's happening with strength in your hips, your core, your pelvic floor, look at mobility of your spine, your hips, your posture, what kind of stabilization mechanisms you have. And we do that with an internal and an external evaluation of the pelvic girdle. Sessions are usually between 30 and 60 minutes long, and there are a series of appointments between 6 and 12 weeks that focus on exercise interventions to help you improve your function. Basically, going through the different types of incontinence here with the different treatment options that we focus on with pelvic floor physical therapy. So when it comes to stress urinary incontinence, like Dr. Guirguis said, there's usually a mechanical issue. So what we focus on is the actual movement and coordination of the muscles all the way from the diaphragm through the pelvic muscles. So we learn how to breathe efficiently. We learn how to cough efficiently. We apply these coordination concepts to different activities that are causing your symptoms. And that can be as simple as coughing, laughing, sneezing, or it could be as complicated as running, jumping, hopping, turning, whatever kind of sport activity that you're looking to get back to symptomatically. The biggest thing that we see is that diaphragm and the pelvic muscles aren't coordinating well when it comes to the coughing. I'm going to show you a couple videos here. So this is myself laying on the floor. This first video, I'm going to show you how inappropriate coughing mechanics can lead to excessive pressure on the bladder and therefore resulting in leakage. So as I cough, you can tell that I'm almost crunching, creating pressure going down and falling right on top of that bladder, making it very hard for those pelvic muscles to respond to that amount of stress. After a little bit of education and a little core retraining, we can function a little bit more efficiently and allow those pelvic muscles and that abdominal muscle to cough better, taking some of that direct pressure off of the bladder. When it comes to urge urinary incontinence, again, that bladder diary that Dr. Guirguis talked about is so important to kind of get and gather all of the information. And we as physical therapists have a little bit more time with you to spend kind of going through your different habits and trying to figure out what strategies are going to be most effective for you. So improving that bladder filling tolerance is a big thing by delaying toileting or timing the toilet and then monitoring different fluid intakes. Improving that bladder emptying strategy. So making sure that each time that you void, that bladder is completely emptying. We're not having any residual volume. And then muscle tension reduction and stretching. So reducing the stress on the bladder, whether it's from the abdominal wall or the pelvic muscles, we can do that manually and try to get those muscles to relax and decrease the stress on the bladder. Specifically with urgency reduction strategies, some quick things that I can mention to you. Again, a lot of these are going to be individual based, but sometimes just a couple things might help to at least delay maybe 10 minutes or 15 minutes. So let's say you get an urge going up on your toes 10 to 15 times. The calf muscle is the same nerve root as the bladder muscle. So sometimes stimulating that nerve root can help to reduce that urge. Squeezing your pelvic muscles a few times quickly can tell that brain, hey, hold on, my bladder's not actually full. I have a little bit more space and I can maybe delay for a few more minutes. And then a couple other, again, more individual based, but pelvic shifts and distracting the brain or restoration of balance between the muscles. As I said, there's muscles that connect on both sides. They're a hammock, but they're individual from right to left. So if there's imbalances in the tension on one side or the other, we might be able to try some strategies to decrease that tone and then help you get to the restroom quicker without leakage. So you're going to see lots of different things on the market. There's weights, there's chairs that help you contract, there's intravaginal stimulators that give you muscle stimulation, there are laser treatments that are out on the market. All of these things claim to be a one-trick pony and allow you to be more in control of your bladder and your bowel function. And sometimes that works, and that's fantastic. And I hope and I pray that it's easy and quick for everybody. But sometimes these things don't work, and they might not be the best option for you. So being evaluated by a doctor and a physical therapist to really understand what's happening in your body is something that I do recommend for all people. So in conclusion, I just want to remind you that everybody's a little bit different. Every body's different. Every trauma is different. Every pelvic floor is a little bit different. So the goal of physical therapy is to understand your own body and your own function and help you return to normal activities with little to no symptoms. Like I said on the previous slide, there's a lot of quick fixes on the market, but there's limited research that supports all of these things are one thing to be the best thing for everybody. And some of these treatments can be really pricey, anywhere from $500 to $1,000 per session. So going in and seeing what should actually be helpful to you might be the best option. And if one of those options are what the doc recommends, then maybe you can explore that option and see if it helps. But I think it's best to be evaluated by someone who can feel what's going on and help you learn more about your body.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Such great information to share. We have a lot of wonderful questions in our question and answer box. I'd like to remind everyone, you still can ask a question if you'd like to enter that in the question and answer session. And if you see a question that's asked and you'd like to move that up in the queue, please just click on that thumbs up. So we will get started and hopefully we can get to all of them. Can you speak to potential links between fibroids and your urgency, particularly nocturia? And then are there management solutions beyond PTNS and or pelvic floor PT? That might be two questions.
Yeah. So for sure, if you have like a very fibroid, like a big fibroid, or you have a ton of fibroids, or you have a really heavy uterus, it definitely can affect urinary urgency. Again, I mean, if you think about those diagrams that kind of showed, you can't even really appreciate how close the bladder and the uterus are to each other in the pelvis. So if you have like a really big uterus or really big fibroids, it can definitely affect urinary urgency and frequency, and sometimes even stress and incontinence. In terms of management solutions beyond PTNS and PT, again, just like we talked about during the talk, you know, there are options that range from doing things like medications, doing things like the nerve stimulator, Botox in the bladder, and so on. And if you are somebody who has like a really big uterus, I would definitely, you know, chat with a gynecologist about, you know, kind of implications of that as well.
How do we find a pelvic floor physical therapist?
So you can actually find it through our pelvic health website on the Inova website. And we have a list of all of the locations, I believe, on that website. And then, you know, again, you can ask, especially if you have an Inova provider, you can always ask for locations from them as well.
Is there a limit? Oops, I just lost it. Is there a limit to how long you can take meds for overactive bladder? A medicine is helping me, but does that mean I will have to take it for the rest of my life? And are there any risks with long-term usage?
So yeah, I mean, it kind of depends. So similar to what I mentioned with the two different kinds of medications, if you're on an anticholinergic, so that's that like class where there are tons of medications that fit underneath that umbrella, things like the Detrol, Ditropan, Vesicare, those can over time, you know, be associated with the risk of dementia. You know, so the longer you're on it, there is that cumulative effect. And so I would be hesitant to maybe be on those types of medications long term and potentially thinking about either doing a third line therapy or switching to the other class of medications that, you know, to our knowledge, have really no long term implications. And if you are on a medication that is helping, like you can be on it long term. But if you're not wanting to be on a medication long term, again, you know, coming and seeing one of us to talk about your other options, I think is a really good idea. And sometimes I've had patients where they've started with a med, gone to physical therapy, and then been able to come off of the medication. You know, maybe the medication helped them get to a place where they're controlled enough that they could participate in the exercises. And once they were equipped with the tools that came from PT, they were able to wean off of the medication. So, you know, there are a lot of different options and variables depending on your situation.
My urologist has recommended Axonics therapy for overactive bladder and urge incontinence. What do you think of this procedure?
So Axonics is one of the two companies that does that sacral neuromodulation. It's either Axonics or InterStim with Medtronic. Again, I mean, I think it's a very reasonable option. It's a good option if you're looking for something outside of doing medications or looking for something that is more long-term. And so, you know, if you're somebody who is looking for something like that, I think doing what we call sacral neuromodulation, whether it's Axonics or Medtronic, is a very good option.
How do I tell if leaking is stress or urgency, and do diuretics affect all of this?
So again, the difference is going to be, are you leaking with coughing, sneezing, jumping, moving? Are you leaking on the way to the bathroom or both? Because again, you can have both at the same time. They're not like mutually exclusive. Diuretics certainly can affect your bladder. It can definitely increase your risks, especially of the urgency related leakage and the urgency and frequency, because the whole point of a diuretic is to make you, you know, urinate out the fluid in your body.
Can a pessary cause more weakness in the ligament, since it is essentially doing the job of the ligament, and it is the ligament itself is not being used as much? And so when the pessary isn't in, does incontinence increase?
So they're kind of two sort of separate questions. So the pessary itself doesn't weaken your ligaments. Actually, what will weaken your ligaments more, stretch your ligaments more, is the prolapse just continuing to, you know, bulge down, because, you know, time and gravity, and the longer that you're kind of just pulling on that ligament with the prolapse descending, those ligaments will continue to stretch and be less functional. Having a pessary in place basically helps to take all that tension off of those ligaments as kind of, you know, that are being dragged down with the prolapse. In terms of the pessary increasing leakage, so the pessary in and of itself does not increase leakage. There is a little bit of nuance here where if you have a pessary in place for prolapse that doesn't have that extra knob that comes with, you know, comes for the stress related leakage, and you actually have that issue where you have the weakening or an issue with the urethra where you, you know, would have that leakage, once we push everything up, you might notice that you're leaking with coughing, laughing, and sneezing. So the pessary itself is not causing that problem. It's just, it's kind of unearthing the fact that you have this problem. Because what can happen is maybe you have some leaking with coughing, laughing, sneezing. The prolapse is mild. As prolapse will get worse, your urethra where you pee from starts to kink. And then you might notice that as your prolapse gets really bad, your leaking gets better because you're kinking off the urethra. And then once you flatten it out, now you're revealing this problem that already exists. So it doesn't cause leakage, but it might uncover a problem that you actually have in addition to the prolapse if it doesn't have that extra piece in the pessary.
Noticed my issue mainly happens during sleep, with a little leakage sometimes. What can be done about this?
So this, I think, typically will fall under the urgency related or overactive bladder. So it would likely be treated in that way. But again, you would need more information. And I would say definitely talk with a provider about it, especially if it's bothersome to you, you know, to kind of figure that out.
Can you talk a little about the link to the link of the bladder to hormone changes?
For sure, as we age, we start to lose our estrogen. Estrogen in the genitourinary tract, so in the vagina, the bladder, the urethra, acts as an anti-inflammatory. As you start going through menopause, or even, in several years leading up to menopause, so I see it actually even in women in their young 40s, you may start to lose that estrogen in the urinary tract. And so then what happens is you may actually notice an increase, especially in the urgency-related symptoms, urgency of urination, leaking with the urge, because now there's a lot of inflammation in your urinary system. And so, we didn't really get into the estrogen side of things, but using estrogen vaginally can actually help to improve those urgency symptoms and overactive bladder, urgency incontinence as well, if you're somebody who that's kind of part of the problem. And, that can actually even be treated by like a gynecologist or a primary care doctor. Like the vaginal estrogen generally is, something anybody can prescribe as long as they feel comfortable with it. But for sure, as your estrogen decreases, your chances of urinary issues increase, and you can even have some increases in the stress-related incontinence as well, because again, just the tissue in the vagina and in the support tissue just kind of changes as you lose that estrogen.
You may have touched on this, but how does a prolapsed uterus affect stress continence?
Yeah, so I mean, again, the prolapse itself doesn't really do anything for the stress incontinence. But like I said, as prolapse starts to get worse, you might notice the incontinence getting better, and it's because that urethra is kinking. So if you're going to be treated for the prolapse and you have that leakage, I would ask about getting treated for both things at the same time.
There are certain trends on bladder health for women who have had hysterectomies. Are there any best practices for those of us who have had hysterectomies and want to be proactive about urinary health?
ET, physical therapy, I think is a really great option. If you're maybe not having symptoms or you're having mild symptoms, even if you go for and all that stuff, kind of talk more about this, but if you go for like two sessions, just to be aware of your pelvis, I mean, you really learn a lot about your pelvic floor going to pelvic floor PT. And I say this not just as a urogynecologist, but as a woman who has gone to pelvic floor PT, even in just one or two sessions, you can learn a lot about your pelvic floor and learn techniques that really take, again, that pressure off the pelvis and help to make things, function more normally.
I'm a little bit biased on this, but I think anyone who's had any kind of abdominal, back, pelvic, or hip surgery should have an evaluation, hopefully by someone who has more extensive knowledge in pelvic floor and the core, so that you can really just kind of jumpstart your recovery and realize that there's a lot of trauma that happens with a lot of those surgeries. So understanding and getting your function back from the get-go is so important and essential.
This next question, I think you somewhat answered it. It talks a little bit about, incontinence due to injury, and how do you know if it's ligaments versus just a weak pelvic floor due to childbirth? And, is that the best way to figure out what the source is and the best treatment through?
Yeah. So, I'll often use weakening of the pelvic floor and injury to the pelvic floor relatively interchangeably, because a lot of the time the weakening of the floor, of the pelvic floor, comes from injury. So the inciting factor, the thing that creates the problem, is usually some sort of trauma, usually most commonly a vaginal delivery. Even if you don't tear, like you don't see a tear and you have to have stitches, you often can still have tears underneath the surface you don't know about, or stretch injuries. So especially with the urinary incontinence, like that mechanical injury that we talk about, you're not usually getting tears up in that part of, your vagina. But what's happening is those ligaments and those support structures, the muscles, all of that, are being stretched beyond what's normal for those muscles. And then that creates the weakening, or the injury, leads to the weakening over time, and so that's kind of how it all relates. So injury, weakening of the pelvic floor, for sure. If you've had a vaginal delivery and you're having symptoms, there is correlation.
I want to respect everyone's time. At 6 o'clock, we have a couple more questions. If you want to stay on for just one or two more minutes, everyone will get a recording of a session if you can't stay on. How does obesity, or why does obesity, contribute?
question. You know, again, a lot of what we've been talking about is putting pressure on the pelvic floor, you know, gravity and so on being a part of it too. So that, you know, naturally the heavier that you are, the more weight is being put on your pelvic floor. Just like, you know, you think about the weight that's being put on your hips, your knees, your ankles. Like people who are heavier tend to have a lot more issues with arthritis in their knees, maybe need knee replacements and so on. Same thing with the pelvic floor. It's just, you know, it's a matter of, you know, that weight really puts pressure on the pelvic floor. And so, you know, it increases the chance of having issues with it over time because of just the pressure.
Let's see. This is a great question. I see ads that say Kegels can actually damage your pelvic floor and are counterproductive. Are there any comments on this?
I would say that the situations where Kegels would be more of a harm would be if you're somebody who has, you know, if you have like a tight pelvic floor, that would be a situation where you don't want to tighten it more, right? You need to work on relaxing, and you don't necessarily know that without seeing, you know, a gynecologist, urogynecologist, or a physical therapist. Or, you know, if you're doing it during a time where you shouldn't, right? So like I've had people come and tell me, oh, well, you know I'm doing my Kegels right because when I'm sitting on the toilet and peeing, I'll do my Kegel and I stop my urine. So I know it's working. And that's a really bad way to check if you're doing it right, because you're basically trained, like we've learned, right? There's a lot of training that happens with the bladder. You train your bladder over time to either go every 30 minutes or to go every 8 hours, you know? And so if you are consistently doing a Kegel in the middle of a void, you're going to train your bladder that like, oh, I'm halfway empty, but I should stop because that's what I do all the time. So the time to do a Kegel is going to be not a time where you're emptying your bladder or emptying your bowels. It's going to be in a setting where you're sitting at your desk or sitting at a stoplight or doing something else. So that would be where Kegels, you know, could cause more problems, is if you have a tight pelvic floor to begin with, or if you're doing it during a set time where you're meant to be relaxing your pelvic floor.
We have time for one more question. I don't want to push our time here. You mentioned that urethral bulking is good for roughly 7 years. I've heard that surgery in general is a short-term solution, but I didn't realize there were multiple options. Are there other types of surgery more permanent, or are they all temporary?
So nothing we do is 100%. You know, just like, again, I reference, I know a lot to like orthopedic surgery, but it's because, again, it's that similar situation where, you know, if you get a knee replaced, it's good for what, 10, 15 years. If you do bulking, you know, depending on the specific agent we use, it could be anywhere from 7 years to, you know, maybe a little bit more, maybe a little bit less. Things like the mid-urethral slings last longer, you know, the other types of slings and so on. We have data suggesting, again, like that 10 to 15 year. Nothing lasts forever, and nothing is 100% success rate. You know, as you saw from the percentages that I mentioned, you get like 80%, 85%, you know, a chance of being completely, you know, completely dry. But like, it's nothing is 100%, I guess I should say. So, you know, even though it's maybe it could be considered sort of a temporary solution, but it depends on how you, I think you define temporary, you know, because something like, you know, a medication, for example, even though it's for the urge, you know, is something that you can do for temporary or for a long time, or you can do something that maybe lasts a little longer. So again, nothing lasts forever and nothing is 100%, but you can get a long period of good relief. And even if you do one type of procedure and then down the road do another procedure, you know, it adding up, you can get a lot of relief. So just because you do a bulking doesn't mean you can't do a sling later on. Just because you do a sling doesn't mean you can't do a bulking later on.
Great. Well, I think we are just about out of time. And I want to thank our speakers this evening. We all learned a great deal. I'm sorry we weren't able to get to everyone's questions this evening. We hope to hold another presentation in the next few months with other presenters from Inova. If you do feel the need for a consultation or pelvic floor therapy, please reach out to schedule an appointment with our presenters or our physicians. Sue can put a link in the chat to our urogynecology web page so that you can meet our team. Once you leave the webinar today, a survey will pop up on your screens. We'd appreciate it if you could complete that and provide your feedback. You will also receive a follow-up email in about a week with a link to view the recording of today's webinar. So on behalf of Inova, thank you again for joining us tonight.